Are they keeping bees on the cover as well?
They should do. I mean, the thing about white clover is its flowering season isn't that long, so you'd need to have other things as well at different times of the year. Yeah?
Isn't that plant getting drier? I mean, it needs a lot of water.
Yeah, that's the main reason for mowing. It reduces the use of water by the clover. If you take away the leaves, it's not using so much water, but that could be a problem, yeah.
The implication of what you say is that we can't destroy all the flowers and the decanter or whatever. We'll still need flowers even with a system like this, and some crops like potatoes will still require flowers.
Yeah, probably. Also, you know, you can't grow clover on the same piece of ground forever. It is very persistent. It can last for up to 25 years, but it's quite likely that at some point the clover is going to get a disease. And you know what you've got there is sort of not quite a monoculture of clover, but you've got an awful lot of it. So there are other plants that you can use for the bottom layer. But this is what I mean when I say it's not a panacea, but I think it's a very useful tool. So moving on a bit, although still staying on the same farm, this is also what's known as an agroforestry farm. And an agroforestry means combining tree crops with field crops or vegetable crops. And so here you can see there's the clover with vegetables in it or about to be planted in it, and here's a line of trees. That's plum, that's a very small walnut. The next picture is sort of more mature version of the same thing, with a crop of wheat with walnuts above. And this, as I said, you know, this is another way in which we can go, is towards feeding ourselves more through nuts, which is perfectly possible. You know, there's no biological reason why nuts should not be our staple. But there's a huge cultural reason why they should not.
And squirrels.
Squirrels are more of a problem when you're growing nuts on a small scale. If you've got a population of squirrels, and as you have in most sort of leafy suburbs, and you have three nut trees in your garden, I can guarantee that you will not eat a single nut.
Unless you've got an air rifle.
Well, even then, because they'll just come in from outside. But if you have got 2 hectares of nuts out in the countryside somewhere, the squirrels may take 5%, or in a bad year, 10%. But that will leave you with 95 to 90% of your crop. So there's one case where small is not beautiful. nuts. I mean, huge potential in the long run. And the next bit, yeah?
I'll ask something. There's one wild nut tree in fruit, which I know, and I picked up nuts under it, and they were all shriveled up. Is that something that just happened this year, or is it a bad tree?
Those are the ones that squirrels don't eat.
Oh, I see.
Squirrels would have eaten all the ones that actually had nuts inside them before you got there.
All right.
It was a good year for nuts this year because there's so much rain.
One small contribution. We happen to have an agroforestry system on our farm, and we've currently got grass and clover on which sheep are grazing, but the trees are also providing a good source of sink for carbon, which is very valuable. And also creating a good recycling of nutrient through the leaf fall and so on. Mm. At the same time as influencing the evaporation loss from the field between because of the reduction in wind speed. And I think that's quite a big point in that, and the crops that grow between benefit from that microclimate that is achieved.
Yeah, there's a huge range of beneficial interactions. I remember who you are now. I visited your farm. as Bill has said, there are some. Those are some of the beneficial interactions, and there are a lot of others. And what you find when you get a more diverse system like that is that the yield you get is greater than you could get by having two monocultures side by side, because of those kinds of beneficial interactions. Yeah. So here we have some more walnut trees, which are in a public place in a town. And in this case, it's just simply because this development was built where there had previously been an orchard, and that those are walnuts and this is a medley. But there's actually no reason why we shouldn't grow an awful lot of our food in towns. And in fact, there's every reason why we should. Yeah?
Is there any reason why we could grow nuts where there's been traditional commercial forestry, the conifers, that so many people have turned against for lots of reasons, not least because they're limited economic value. Could you introduce nuts into woodland environments?
It's hard. There's a big difference between growing a timber tree and a nut tree. Timber trees need to be grown close together so they draw each other up, so that the lower branches are suppressed by shade, and so you get nice tall straight trunks which you can put through a sawmill. Whereas to get nuts, you need to have sun reaching every part of the canopy, because where you don't get sun, you don't get nuts or fruit. So you need more of an orchard structure. Also, for nuts to actually replace conifers is relatively unlikely to work, because most conifer plantations are put in places that are bad for farming, usually in the uplands, where the climate and the soil is not very good. Whereas walnuts need good conditions, quite cold sensitive, and they need decent soil and so forth. So the two things aren't, it's much more a case of can the nuts replace the wheat fields, rather than the nuts replace the conifers.
Also, nuts replaced in a city like this, some of your street trees.
Absolutely. And that's what I'm trying to illustrate with this picture here. There's absolutely no reason why all the trees in the city shouldn't be nut trees. Well, the only one is squirrels, actually, but... and fruit trees and nut trees. Because, yeah, I'll come to you in a moment, if you look at the energy cost, because so far I've just been looking at the soil and the trees and things like that, but also we've got to think of energy cost. I mean, another of the advantages of the bicropping system is it uses very much less energy. Under experiments, it's been found to use 50% of the energy of growing wheat conventionally. But if you look at the food system as a whole, something like 1% of our energy expenditure is used on farms. Something like 12% of our energy expenditure is used in transporting and processing food. So actually growing stuff in the city, where the people live, or growing stuff in our own back gardens, is going to have more effect than the way in which it is grown. Where it is grown will have more effect than how it is grown. So although I've been banging on about that quite a bit, I'd like to move on now. Can we have the windows drawn, the curtains drawn? Because that's the last slide, and you can switch off. Someone else had a question. Yes.
Yes, if you were planting, for example, walnuts and street trees, what kind of treatment would you need in their root zone to enable them actually to thrive?
Well, it's a good question. I mean, what kind of, you'd need to make sure that they had sufficient soil, sufficient moisture, and sufficient nutrients. And it might not be so in every case, because there's a difference between a tree surviving and a tree producing an abundant and worthwhile crop of nuts. Mm-hmm. So it might be necessary to do quite a bit of remediation. Yeah. Right, where are we? Yeah, okay. So, I got a little bit ahead of myself there. We'll come back to that in a moment, actually, sort of purchasing patterns. I'd just like to say a few more things about what goes on the farm. And the next one is about animals. Now, animals are currently very important to sustainable farming because they enable a rotation to take place. I mentioned that before, you'll have an alternation of grassland with clover in it and cereal crops. So the grassland phase is building up the fertility and the cereal phase is using it. And animals are crucial to that, because how else can you use grassland? You know, we can't eat it. You could devote it purely to increasing fertility. But as things stand at the moment, it is difficult. I won't say it's impossible, but it's very difficult to grow food organically and economically without including animals.